Today is March 4th, 2015. If 2 years ago today, on March 4th, 2013, Dr. Squires had told me I was going to be giving today's presentation, I would have asked him what funny weed he'd been smoking. Because what I'm going to share with you this afternoon was not on my life's agenda. And what I'm going to share with you this afternoon came to light literally within walking distance of this auditorium. I'd like to see a show of hands. How many people know that we have homeless people in Volusia County? Did anybody not know that? Okay. How many people know that we have homeless cats in Volusia County? Homeless cats, stray cats, wild cats, unowned cats, or the moniker that elevates them to the level of a protected species, seems like everybody knows that. Feral cats. In Volusia County, where we live, the homeless people are eating the feral cats. And I know that because someone who had been homeless and who had been eating the feral cats told me so. And he told me at the same time that he told a group of high school students at Mainland High School, right across the street, where I was a business partner in the spring of 2013. And he told the students that the cats were a recognizable form on a grill. And as we walked out of the auditorium, he turned to me and he said, "Judith, I know that sounded horrible, but I can assure you, the days that we could find hamburgers in the dumpsters, we didn't eat the cats on those days." So after his presentation, the course instructor, who happens to have been my very first client when I started my practice here in Daytona, took me, the business partner, and the guest lecturer to lunch. And I shared with them something that I had heard about twice before. And that was the association between toxoplasmosis, the parasite in cat feces, and the devastating mental illness that was schizophrenia. I'm going to leave that lunch conversation for a few minutes and talk about each of these things. Toxoplasmosis by itself is a humongous topic. And I'm going to lay the most devastating mental illness on top of that. My goal when you leave here this afternoon is that you will leave with a concise fund of knowledge. Let me start with the parasite. This is what we see on the normal cat fecal exam. This is only found in cat feces. And by cat, I mean anything felidae. House cat, bobcat, puma, tiger, lion, snow leopard, all of them. And only in their feces, their waste, their excrement, their caca, their doo-doo, their poo-poo, their dung, and the S word I'm not supposed to say on video. Okay, this is what we see on a typical cat fecal exam under the microscope. This is an ascarid or a roundworm egg. So when you've seen wormy kittens and you see those spaghetti looking things coming out of their rumps, okay, that's the egg from one of those. This is typical coccidia, single-celled organism. This isn't an egg, this is an oocyst. This is what we typically see. Toxoplasma is also a coccidia, but it's teeny weeny. This right here is right there. And next to that is a toxoplasma oocyst. This is so small, this is about the size of a lymphocyte. The veterinary school at Gainesville, the University of Florida, has never diagnosed a cat with toxoplasmosis on a fecal exam. It's always been on a blood test. This parasite is found on every continent on the planet, including Antarctica. Okay, somebody shared with me earlier that some of the terminology is laborious. So I just like us all to be saying these terms so they become familiar to you. Can we all say toxoplasma together?
Toxoplasma.
Yes, thank you. All right, now let's talk about this. If you know 110 people, then you know someone who has schizophrenia. Who is your someone? Who is your someone? This is not some wild idea that Judith Milcarsky, house call vet in Daytona Beach, came up with. This is Johns Hopkins leading this country and about 42 other researchers from around the world over the last decade that have made this association. Okay. Let me talk about mental illness. Now, I am addressing a human medical mental condition through the lens of veterinary medicine. On one end of the spectrum, we have clinical depression. Moving on, you have bipolar disorder, which is depression and mania or euphoria in the same individual. At the far end of the spectrum is schizophrenia, the hallmark of which is hearing voices. And between schizophrenia and bipolar disorder is a hybrid condition called schizoaffective disorder, with manifestations of both conditions in the same individual. We used to think of this as points on a continuum, and now we regard these as points on a grid. These are inherited as a cluster, and all of them refer back to brain chemistry. And I'm talking the biggies: acetylcholine, norepinephrine, gamma-aminobutyric acid, serotonin, dopamine, and in the case of schizophrenia, also glutamate. Since I have been working on this in the last 23 and a half months, I have read 8 volumes on this and countless numbers of scientific journal articles. If you only have time in your life to read one item on this condition, my recommendation would be Dr. E. Fuller Torrey's book, Surviving Schizophrenia. It is the single most comprehensive manuscript on this topic. Okay, let me go back. The week before the guest lecturer came to speak to the students, we were doing an environmental survey on that piece of property behind Kmart across the street from Halifax Medical Center, where there was a feral cat colony. We were there to do an environmental survey. We were sampling soil. There were reportedly 80 cats on the property at the time that we went. This dark image that you see here, that is a cat in this makeshift enclosure, and those black spots, those are flies. This animal barely moved the entire hour we were there. This is one of the most difficult situations I have encountered as a veterinarian. I was there with a police officer, a course instructor, an assistant principal, and 8 high school students. I didn't have so much as a stethoscope around my neck. And no one presented this animal to me to be cared for. This is one of the community cats. They have no owners. This is where these animals were being fed. 80 animals were supposedly being fed at these feeding sites. This was being promoted as a well-managed feral cat colony. The students peeked up under this tarp and said there were multiple bottles of half-filled green, presumably algae water. Approximately 10 yards from where these cats were being fed, there were 4 homeless campsites. The homeless people had been evacuated from this area approximately the week before. That's why we were under police escort. I shared with the students that if they found cat turds, there was an 80% chance of recovering parasites that are transmissible to people if you found a single cat poop. If you sampled the soil directly beneath the infected cat feces, the chance of recovery drops to 1 in 5 simply because of dilution. So I shared with the students, we had 8 students. They sampled 1 in front, 1 behind each of 4 campsites. I said to the students, if one of you recovers parasites from cat feces in the soil, that will be interesting. And if 2 of you do, that'll be really fascinating. Only 1 student in 8 did not recover feline fecal parasite from the soil around these campsites. That's how heavy the contamination was in this area. Back to my lunch meeting. I shared this information about toxoplasma and schizophrenia with a course instructor and with a guest lecturer, and they said I couldn't sit on it any longer. Let me tell you the other 2 times that I came across this. The first was about 8 years before I worked with the students. I was one of a 4 veterinarian committee in Volusia County, and we were looking at another public health issue in feral cats, and that was feral cats and rabies. And at the time, I said, I'm overwhelmed with rabies. I don't need to look at that right now. And in the 10 years since, we have had 50 terrestrial, that would be non-bat, cases of rabies in Volusia County, of which 11 have been cats and none have been dogs. 8 months before I worked with the students, a local colleague put this image in front of me. This is out of the Atlantic magazine. This is Dr. Yaroslav Fleger. He is an evolutionary biologist from St. Charles University in the Czech Republic. He recognized back in the 90s that he was behaving in strange and self-destructive ways, like he was walking into traffic. And he got himself tested for toxoplasmosis and he came up positive. And since then, he has researched this extensively, over 113 publications to his name before January 1st of this year. This was a hard image to shake. This is one of Dr. Fleger's research articles. So what he did, he looked at 44 people who had the diagnosis of schizophrenia. 12 of those people tested positive for the parasite Toxoplasma. He compared them to 56 controls who did not have mental illness and who did not have a first or second degree relative with mental illness. So no parents, no children, no grandchildren, no great grandparents, no nieces, no nephews, no aunts, uncles, or cousins. 13 of those 56 controls also tested positive for Toxoplasma. So just testing positive for Toxoplasma does not mean necessarily that you will get schizophrenia. What is shown here are MRI composite of MRI images of the people who had schizophrenia. One of the hallmarks of this condition is a loss of gray matter. In the top frame is a composite of all 44 subjects who had schizophrenia. The bottom are the subjects who had schizophrenia and who tested negative for Toxoplasma. In the middle are the people who had schizophrenia and tested positive for the parasite. It may very well be that Toxoplasma-associated schizophrenia may be its own variant of this mental illness. Okay. I wasn't ready for that. I was there to do an environmental survey, not talk about mental illness. So I took this to a variety of people. And I do want to tell you why I didn't pursue it after Dr. Flager. I was invited through animal control by the assistant police chief of the city of Port Orange, that's the city I live in, to attend the first official feral cat meeting of my city. And as I walked in the door, the county's most vocal feral cat activist put a finger in my face and said to me, "We're not going to have a rabies dance today." When I got inside the building, the county's second most vocal feral cat activist said, "We found out that your husband is a doctor." And he is. "You need to go home and tell your doctor husband to put you on medication because you need it." I do not have a serious mental illness, but I now know what it feels like to be accused of having a serious mental illness. I have asthma, but no one has ever accused me of having asthma. If a veterinarian could be accused of having a serious mental illness for voicing concerns over the fatal disease that is rabies, then what would be said about a veterinarian who is making a connection between a parasite found in cat poop and the most devastating mental illness? So I backed off until this guest lecturer. And at his request and that of the science teacher, I sent out a memo. Most of it, many recipients were elected officials, thankfully. The mayor of Daytona Beach was the first acknowledgement that I received, and I asked several questions. As it turns out, I was not the first person, and I wasn't even the first veterinarian in Volusia County to know the homeless people were eating feral cats. And then I had to talk to the students, because I noticed that a number of them were using the terms of mental illness to throw barbs and insults at each other. Things like, "Dude, you're acting psychotic," or, "Girlfriend, you need to up your meds." And I suggested to the students that they trade the terms of diabetes for the terms of mental illness and see how comfortable that felt. Because after all, the highs and lows of blood sugar can alter mental status. So I said to them, "Why don't you consider saying, 'Dude, you're acting a little ketotic,' or, 'Girlfriend, you need to up your insulin.'" Yeah, they looked at me like I had just come from Mars. But I got the point across, and none of them made those insults to each other, at least in my presence, for the rest of the semester. In our society, we tend to segregate the diseases of the body from the diseases of the brain. We even separate the things the brain does. The brain controls motion and emotion. If you have seizures, you are sainted. If you hear voices, you are damned. Epilepsy is a diagnosis, but schizophrenia is a sentence. So I took this, my concerns, to the people in my world, most of them my clients. And one of my clients is a psychiatric nurse who works with our county's adolescents, who said to me, "You," and I'm talking you veterinarians, "need to prove that there is no association between toxoplasmosis and schizophrenia before one more feral cat gets put on one more elementary school campus." And that brings me to the next topic. The homeless people are not the only vulnerable segment of society. So too are the school children on whose campuses feral cat colonies are being placed. This is an image of Horizon Elementary School, the first official feral cat colony of the city of Port Orange. This colony has been there for 14 years that we know of. I found out about this in the fall of 2011 when another client whose child went to that school was asked to be a parent chaperone for a fall festival and said, "The cats are approaching the children on the playground and the playground is almost entirely sand." This is an image taken after school hours when it's all locked up. The cats were coming in and out. The hardware on these gates was absolutely no obstacle to these animals. This is an image of the cats towards the evening hour waiting for their meal. The area you're looking at here is a parking area contiguous with the school, is contiguous with a city park. On two separate occasions, I very easily and quickly recovered fecal samples from this area. Out of 11 fecal samples, 9 contained hookworm eggs, hookworm being the causative agent for creeping eruption, also called cutaneous larva migrans. And this is what it looks like in an adult, and this is what it looks like in a child. Attendance at school is mandated by the state and designated by the district. These parents have no choice as to where their children go. We're supposed to be sending children to school to prepare for life. But if Johns Hopkins is right, then if the life they're is the life they're getting prepared for, life on the street. One of the people I spoke with about this is a police officer who told me that certain members of law enforcement knew about this situation, the homeless people eating the feral cats, somewhere between 2009 and 2010. And the officer and I had a discussion about mental illness and criminality. Statistically, people with serious mental illness have a far greater chance of being a crime victim than they do a crime perpetrator. That said, if you look at who is incarcerated in this country, 50 to 80% of the people in prison in this country suffer from serious mental illness. There are more people in this country with mental illness in the prison system than in the mental health system. The officer and I discussed that if you look at the Gabrielle Giffords incident, the Batman movie incident, the Navy shipyard incident, those were all three committed by young men who were diagnosed with schizophrenia. While they may be outliers, when an adverse event happens, they tend to take a lot of innocent people with them. And I said to the officer, if Johns Hopkins is correct, if there is an association between toxoplasmosis and schizophrenia, then by placing feral cat colonies on elementary school campuses, and the officer cut me off and said, "This will not be a discussion of gun control. This will be a discussion of animal control." Raise your hand if you do not know what dirt feels like in your mouth.
Don't remember.
Okay, one. Okay. Everybody good so far? All right. Let's talk about this parasite. Whoops. Okay, you gotta be smarter than the equipment. There we go. All right, Toxoplasma gondii. Let's say this together. Oocysts? Thank you. This is what it comes out of the cat. On the left side is what it looks like immediately after the cat defecates it into the environment. And on the right side is what it looks like in 3 to 5 days when it has had a chance to sporulate. There are 2 sporocysts, each containing 4 sporozoites. So there's 8 infective forms in 1 oocyst. Infectious dose for a human for toxoplasmosis is a single oocyst. These are infectious in the environment for approximately 18 months. This is the result of sexual reproduction. When the male gametes and the female gametes get it on in the kitty intestine, nothing says love like cat gut. Okay, the person who discovered that phenomenon, his name is Dr. Jitender Dubey. He's now with the USDA. He literally wrote the book on toxoplasmosis. This was his PhD research that was published in 1970. These are tachyzoites. Everybody say that with me. Ooh, you're good. Okay, thank you. This is the rapidly dividing form. This is what is in our tissues for approximately 2 weeks. This is the stage that we can affect a treatment if we treat the if we find out that the person or animal has it within the first 2 weeks of infection. These are bradyzoites. Can you say this with me? Thank you. This is the slowly reproducing form. The bradyzoites and the tachyzoites reproduce by asexual reproduction. There can be as few as 2 bradyzoites or as many as 2,000, and they are contained in cysts. We used to think that these cysts hung out in our bodies and didn't bother us at all. And now we're finding that these are indeed biologically active. Toxoplasma can infect every cell in your body that has a nucleus, which means every cell in your body except for a red blood cell. The symptoms that occur depend on where it happens to land in what organ. Does that make sense? Okay. Toxoplasmosis can infect any endotherm, any warm blood, any mammal, and any bird. It was first discovered in this little rodent. This is the Tenodactylus gundi, and I see some eyes squinting. Wait a minute, that says G-U-N, and you've been saying G-O-N. I know when they first reported it, they spelled it wrong. That was like the ultimate minus 10, but this misspelling stuck. This little rodent is about the size of a hamster and looks like a guinea pig with these really cool circular ears. Tenodactylus means he has the combed foot. This discovery was made in 1908. This is a picture of the alala, the Hawaiian crow, one of the most susceptible birds to this parasite. No longer found in the wild, this bird succumbed to not only feral cat predation, but also its extreme susceptibility to toxoplasma. Everybody with me so far? Okay, so if you have fur or feathers, you can get toxoplasma. Let's go through the life cycle. I'm going to give you just a moment with this. Can we go on? I'm going to go through each of these in turn. Is that acceptable? Okay. Let's start with the first one. Cats defecate oocysts into the environment. I'm putting these little icons in the corner to remind us what stage of the parasite we're looking at or dealing with. Dr. Dubay has a saying, cats don't bury their feces, cats hide their feces. It takes 3 to 5 days to be infective. If the cat removes one of the senses from being observed, that pretty much assures that the parasite has time to develop to an infectious stage. That makes sense? Okay, so cats defecate oocysts into the environment. Foraging prey animals ingest the oocysts, feces dry, get distributed. Oocysts infect the prey animal first by tachyzoites, which then become bradyzoites. We're not exactly sure what happens in this morph, but we know that it occurs. Cat consumes the bradyzoites when it eats the prey animal. Bradyzoite. And then in the cat intestine, sexual reproduction. And then defecates. This photograph was taken when the students did an environmental survey on this campus. Not all cats bury. This cat expertly placed this fecal pile within inches of a sprinkler head, thus guaranteeing maximum dissemination of parasites. It takes, are you ready for this? 3 days from the time a cat eats prey that has bradyzoites in its tissues until it is defecating oocysts into the environment. Okay, full disclosure here. I am seriously into cats. I am enchanted with their essence. And I love the way fur smells. And here's something else. It is just as difficult to euthanize a feral cat as it is to euthanize a geriatric arthritic poodle in congestive heart failure. Those are both animals I have shared the planet with. And with each one, I have to say, if I do not intervene right now, what is the future for that animal? And part C to this is I took an oath to promote public health. This is an image of a feral cat. We know that this animal is feral because it has had the end of its left ear amputated to indicate that its gonads have also been removed. Cats who are missing their gonads are equally competent at spreading parasites in the environment as cats who are intact. Cats can get toxoplasma. Cats can die from this. Cats who die from this parasite typically die from pneumonia. And we see that a lot in kittens, because partly because their immune systems are just not well developed. The average feral cat will distribute 10 million oocysts into the environment when they become infective. If a cat is exposed, he won't be shedding. He'll shed for about 2 weeks, and then he likely won't shed again until 6 years later. 55% of cats who have previously shed, if re-exposed to the parasite, will shed again. But most feral cats don't last that long. I'm going to warn you, there's a difficult slide next, so if you want to avert your gaze, it's okay. And the reason the feral cats don't live long is because of death by vehicle. They're getting hit. I will tell you, if I can scoop these animals up off the concrete without obstructing traffic and without getting myself run over, I do so. This image was taken at 10 minutes to 7 in the morning on the Friday of Bike Week on US 1, one block south of Bevel Road. I was not able to pick this animal up. Something to note, it appears that this animal's scrotum has recently had hair removed, and it appears that his left ear has been shaved and has been tipped. This animal did not need to die this way. This animal could have been humanely euthanized with a barbiturate overdose. This is TNR. This is totally not right. Anybody heard? Who has not heard of this concept before? One Health. Oh, we got a lot of work. I got a lot of work to do. Okay. This started back in the time of the ancient Greeks and has seen a resurgence through the ages. In the last 50 years, veterinary public health has come into its own as a discipline. Essentially, what it means is that for diseases that animals share with people, we can't keep the people healthy until we can first make the animals healthy. Two quintessential examples are rabies and, more recently, Ebola. This is a picture of a Nigerian street butcher. Stray dogs and rabies are part of the society in Nigeria. You can see he's not wearing any protection on his hands. They kill these animals on the street for food. Not all Nigerian street butchers succumb to rabies. Some of them have antibodies. Over here we have bats. In the most recent Ebola outbreak, the index case was a two-year-old child who had come in contact with a fruit bat. Bats carry this as asymptomatic carriers. Curiously, both of these deal with protein sources. You've heard the term bushmeat. This is Daytona Beach bushmeat. I'm on a terminology tangent. This concept was put in front of me by a colleague a couple of months ago. And the thought is that there needs to be a fair and even distribution of environmental benefits and environmental burdens. Songbirds represent both of those. Songbirds are an integral part of the life cycle of this parasite. Preying on them increases toxoplasmosis in the environment. Songbirds are also nature's jewels. Their removal is the removal of an environmental benefit. Okay, and then somebody has asked the very astute question, what happens when cats become part of the food chain? What happens when roadkill cats get eaten by vultures? And the answer to that is that unless something then eats the vulture becomes a dead-end host. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, so up until now, I'm sure you're now saying, excuse me, we were here to talk about people, but we had to get to the part about what was happening in animals, because the parasite does not know that I am not a bird, and the parasite does not know that you are not a rodent. So let's talk about this in humans. I know that life cycles can seem somewhat laborious, so we're going to break this down into three F words. I'm a prude, it'll be okay. Okay, on the far right, we're going to focus on the feces, and then we're going to focus on the food, and then we're going to focus on the fetus. Okay, recalling. Cats get infected by eating raw meat. Cats do not cook their prey before they eat it. And what they eat, they poop. Let's talk about cat litter boxes. Most people know of this parasite as the reason that pregnant women should not clean litter boxes. I have been amazed at how many professionals who are non-medical thought there was something inherently wrong with the clay in the cat litter that was bad for pregnant women. I have encountered other medical professionals who knew there was something wrong in the cat feces, but didn't realize that it was a parasite, much less that it was a parasite called Toxoplasma. Let's talk about gardens. Cats love freshly tilled earth. This is what we call a substrate preference. Let's talk about golf courses. When we talked about rabies, we made a mapping correlation between rabies and feral cats and golf courses in Volusia County. Volusia County has 26 golf courses, 13 have been within the immediate vicinity of a rabies incident, and 4 have actually had rabies on the course, making rabies the only venue where rabies has occurred more than once. We proposed to the University of Florida Parasitology Department, this goes back to 2006, has anybody looked at cat feces and parasites in golf course sand traps? Because to a cat, a golf course sand trap is the mother of all litter boxes. So a veterinary student who was an avid golfer took this on as his senior research project. We sampled 3 courses on the east side of the county and 3 courses on the west. All 6 had larvae consistent with parasites, hookworms and roundworms. And 3 of them, actually, we recovered hookworm and roundworm eggs from the course, which was significant given that the average golf course sand trap contains 22.7 cubic yards of sand, and the sample size could fit in a sandwich baggie. And then let's talk about this. Barn cat, being a barn cat, is the end all if you can't get a feral cat adopted anywhere else. There is a whole niche of feral cat activism dedicated to barn cats. They are good mousers. That tickles their brain. That's what they like to do. And they also defecate and eliminate in the straw, which is a problem for us considering the next item, which is a focus on the food. I'm going to give you just a moment with this because I want you to leave here with this image in your mind. This represents the likelihood of getting infected with toxoplasma from eating raw, rare, or undercooked meat. I have put the little kitty down in this corner in as close a poop brown color as I could manage to remind us that this is where the problem is coming from. So let's start at the bottom. These are bradyzoites that are in these tissues. With the horse, horses get sick for a couple of days with the parasite, and may run a fever, lymph nodes may be enlarged a little bit, and then they throw it off. And we don't eat much horse meat in this country. Chickens are intermediate in terms of susceptibility for birds. And most chicken meat gets frozen before it reaches the consumer. And freezing tends to destroy the activity of the bradyzoites. Cows tend to be relatively resistant. However, we eat a lot of beef in this country, and a lot of people like to eat beef rare. The small ruminants, the goats and sheep, are very susceptible to this parasite. This is a huge production problem in these species. They tend to lose their lambs and their kids before they're born. But we don't eat that much sheep and goat meat in this country. We do eat a lot of pork. 3% of pork in this country is infected with toxoplasma. I have had swine producers come up and whisper in my ear, yeah, that's why I don't let cats in the farrowing house. It is possible to raise toxoplasma-free, free-range pork. You have to keep the rodents away, and you have to keep the cats away. It's hugely labor-intensive, but it is possible. Everybody with me on this? Okay. And we have to consider this. 7 to 20% of the people in this country have been infected with toxoplasmosis. Right now, we think that approximately half are getting infected with oocysts from cat feces, and the other half from eating undercooked meat. In Europe, the chance goes up to about 40%. And part of that is because in Europe, it is customary to eat your meat rare, sangyal. Now let's talk about the fetus. If a mama is pregnant and she gets infected with this parasite in her first trimester, she only has a 10% chance of passing the infection to her unborn child. If she gets infected in the third trimester, the chance of infecting her unborn child increases to 75%. And these are tachyzoites we're talking about here. The difference, though, is in what is the disease manifestation. If she gets infected in her first trimester, the child will likely die, if not in the womb, then shortly after birth. If she gets infected in the third trimester, the child will probably survive, but will probably be severely affected, either mental retardation and or deafness and or blindness. And the deafness and blindness may not manifest until the person is 24 years of age from an in utero infection. Now, what if the mama was infected before, came in contact with the parasite, before she got pregnant and had antibodies? We used to think that unless something dire happened to the mom and her immune system really was destroyed, that she would be protected. Research in the last 5 years has shown that some of these mothers, these bradyzoites that were in their tissues, may be morphing into tachyzoites, and they may be passing on this infection to their unborn child from a prior infection with the parasite. Does that make sense? If they find out that the mama gets infected during pregnancy, they can put her on antibiotics, and they have a 50-50 chance of stopping the infection before it spreads. Hydrocephalus is one of the, saddest manifestations of toxoplasmosis infection in utero. This is, if you Google hydrocephalus and toxoplasma, this little baby is literally the poster baby for this condition. This little baby was treated, Dr. Dubé, who I keep referring to, his PhD mentors were MDs in Sheffield, England, and this little baby was one of their patients. You can see she also was spastic, her little hand was shaking. We were not able to find out how long this child survived after this photo was taken. This was 1955. Okay, let me talk about the eyes for just a minute. On the left side is a photo of the fundus, the back of your eye, as it appears normally. This is what the back of the eye looks like when infected with toxoplasma. Now, this is not a situation where somebody sticks their finger in cat doo-doo and then puts their finger in their eye. That's not how it gets there. This is somehow you ingest it, it gets into your bloodstream, and because the eye is so vascular, that's how the infection starts. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. A dear friend who is a nurse and who loves cats is concerned that when word gets out about this, people are going to be afraid of having cats. Please don't be afraid of having cats. This parasite does not typically cause diarrhea in a cat, and cats are fastidious groomers. Simply associating yourself with a cat and petting a cat is not going to give you toxoplasma. Now, you should always wash your hands after you pet any animal. Dogs are a different story. Two reasons. Dogs like to eat cat poop. It has been demonstrated that dogs can eat cat feces that are contaminated with infectious toxoplasma oocyst, and then the dog acts like a mechanical carrier. So the parasite does not replicate in the dog intestine. We don't look for this parasite in any poop aside from cat poop. But it is possible for the dog to eat feral cat feces in its neighborhood, come home, and then defecate infectious oocyst into its yard. Here's another thing. It is possible to get infectious oocysts off of dog fur. Dogs love, they luxuriate in cat poo. And they don't like to get it off of them. They enjoy the way that smells. Back in the 70s, they noticed that children in Brazil who did not have cats were getting sick with toxoplasma. And when they investigated, they found that the children had dogs. And what was happening is the dogs were going and finding cat feces and rolling in it. They would come into their home, the children would pet the dogs, not wash their hands, and that's how the children were getting infected. This represents our shelters. Shelters grade each other on decreased impoundments and decreased euthanasias. Feral cat colonies represent 80% of the cats that are impounded in shelters, and only 10% of them are adoptable. If a shelter locks out the feral cats, they immediately drop their impoundment rate and they immediately drop their euthanasia rate, which gives them the gold star A+ smiley face on the shelter report card. Okay, remember this? People took a frozen resource and dumped it on each other's heads. This earned $150 million in the course of 3 weeks for ALS. How many people even knew what that stood for, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis? Good for you. Because most people didn't, especially most people who were participating in the ice bucket challenge. 30,000 people in the United States suffer from ALS. 2.2 million people in the United States suffer from schizophrenia. We've all heard that beautiful baritone voice on the radio that says, No broad, joyful smiles by 6 months of age. Perhaps you should consider autism. We do not hear that beautiful baritone voice ask the question, hearing voices at age 19, perhaps you should consider schizophrenia. As a society, we have recognized, sorry, I'm not as good as him. As a society, we have recognized that autism affects the mind at a developmental stage. And as a society, we have yet to recognize that serious mental illness also affects the mind at a developmental stage. We've all heard this, right? If autism speaks, then schizophrenia screams. Silver is the awareness color for schizophrenia. That's why I'm wearing a silver pin. Here. Silver was chosen by the National Alliance for Mental Illness. And I know that sounds counterintuitive because silver is a precious metal, something most people would like to have. I've never known anybody that wanted to have schizophrenia. But the idea was that with therapy and medication, there came a silver lining. There was a chance for a normal life. Let's talk about this. 2.8 million women in the United States have a history of breast cancer, which means that for every 4 women in this country who have a history of breast cancer, there are 3 people who are struggling to live with schizophrenia. I have a serious family history of breast cancer. So serious that for me, it is not a matter of if, it is a matter of when I'm going to get this condition. And when that happens, I will be the recipient of an outpouring of support as my surgeon relieves me of both my malignancy and my femininity. At a time in my life when I have already had my education and a fascinating career, when I have had children and now grandchildren that I adore, and a husband who I am still in love with, a husband who reminds me that a woman is not her breast, but a person is their mind. There is no surgeon who can cut schizophrenia out of someone's brain. That diagnosis is typically made in the late teens to early 20s, right at the point when a person is on the threshold of becoming that someone that they were supposed to be, and society maligns them with derogatory language. We have a long way to go. And you knew we were going to go here. This irreverent annotator image represents both the terminology and the biology of this organism. I'm asking that we stop using the terms of mental illness to malign these people. Let's stop using the terms of mental illness to describe people who got up on the wrong side of the bed and happened to irk us. I want you to think about it from the point of view of the feral cat feeders. For the people who feed the feral cats, that feeding gives them an intensely positive emotional response that nothing else in their life provides. I'm going to ask you a question, but I don't want you to answer it out loud. What is the one thing in your life that you hold most dear? If I threatened to take that away from you, how would you respond to me? Let's use another term, eleurophilia. This makes sense. It's technical, it's scientific, it's specific, and it doesn't malign them. Let's leave the other terms for the people who have to deal with mental illness. Their task is hard enough as it already is. You cannot diagnose schizophrenia on a simple blood test. There may be a biological reason behind this. This is what a normal rodent does when it smells cat urine. Right? And this is mediated by pathways that go to the hypothalamus that says fear. There are other pathways that go to the amygdala that elicit a reproductive response. Rodents who are infected with toxoplasma have a situation here. That parasite causes this message to jump signals. So the rodent who is infected with toxoplasma, that rodent smells cat urine, and he says, well, hello there. What if the whole point was for the cat to get a meal? Now, this whole business about predator urine smells, the toxoplasma-infected rodents retain their fear of other predators. This only applies to cats. These rodents' brains that are infected with toxoplasma have 15% more dopamine than uninfected rodents. In fact, this parasite has two genes that code for tyrosine hydroxylase, the rate-limiting enzyme for the production of dopamine. If you treat these rodents with anti-dopaminergic compounds, they regain their fear of cats. May I go on? Okay, so that had to do with the cats. The Volusia County Health Department said to us, look, maybe this is happening, maybe not. You veterinarians need to prove that toxoplasma is in the animals in this county. And if you can do that, then we will address the citizens. And we're going to address the homeless people with the same level of concern as we're going to address the school children. Because a citizen is a citizen, whether they are on the playground or on the street. And somebody asked the question, can dogs get toxoplasma? Because no self-respecting dog turns down cat poo. So we called Dr. Dubay and said, what about this? And he said, well, okay, but the only thing you can do is take a titer. A titer is an antibody level. All you can do is a blood test to see if they've been exposed. And in this situation, exposure and infection are equal. Let me take a sidestep here. Exposure is not when you are, let's say, the missus of the house is watching television in her family room, and on the other side of the wall, the feral cats of the neighborhood have been using her foundation planting as a latrine. That is not exposure. Exposure is when that missus goes out the next day and weeds in her plant bed with no gloves. And her husband, being the dutiful husband that he is, recognizes how long and how hard his wife has been toiling and fixes her a bologna sandwich and brings it to her, which she gratefully accepts, does not wash her hands. That's infection. Infection and exposure with this parasite mean the same. If you have antibodies, you've been exposed. If you have antibodies, you have been infected. You have bradyzoites. Does that make sense? And we think the antibodies hang out for life. Okay, so Dr. Dubay said, look, nobody has looked at this in dogs in the United States, own dogs, in decades. If nothing else, that's good information to have. See if you can get your hands on 50 dogs out of Florida and we'll see what we can do with it. Actually, we got our hands on 51 dogs out of Florida in 5 Florida counties. And the only criteria was that the owners knew that those dogs were eating outside cat poop. 37% of those dogs tested positive for toxoplasma. Now, someone could honestly and legitimately argue that we did not know that those dogs were not also sneaking raw pork off of their owners' countertops. And they're right. So in July, we came out with a study with the USDA. This is a national study. And what we are doing is trying to determine if owned dogs can be a sentinel for environmental contamination with toxoplasma. So I'm very proud of the fact that I got my name on the little same piece of paper real estate as Dr. Dubay. I have this to share if you would like. I can share this with you. Somebody's taking pictures. What started as a concern in the classroom of my very first client has ended up in the lab of the world's leading expert for toxoplasmosis. For a practicing veterinarian, it just doesn't get any more profound than that. We're calling this the Silver Leash Project. Silver to recognize that sets the awareness color for schizophrenia, and leash to acknowledge that these are owned dogs contributing to science as man's best friend. So what we're doing, this is a match controlled study. So if I have a 3-year-old castrated male Cocker Spaniel I know is eating outside cat poop, he will get matched with a 3-year-old castrated male Cocker Spaniel as close in geography as we can find them. That animal does not have that history, and we'll send in the samples together. And the USDA is blinded as to which is which. We are on the leading edge of this. Finding controls and test subjects to match is a challenge. So we're going to be at this a while. 10 days before our article appeared, this came out in the Journal of our profession, Survey to Probe Veterinarians' Mental Health. Veterinarians have 4 times the suicide rate of the general population and 2x that of the other health professions. There are also links between the parasite toxoplasma and suicide. We handle cat poop for a living. This was an online survey. It got published in the CDC's Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Reports February 13th, just a couple of weeks ago. And what they have assessed is that 1 in 10 practicing veterinarians right now may be experiencing psychological distress. And 1 in 10 practicing veterinarians right now have at some point had suicidal ideation since graduation from vet school. That's huge. Okay, 2 weeks ago today, we got our second study approved by the USDA. This is a human study. We're calling this the Silver Band Project, and veterinarians are the hub. This is another nationwide study. I am fielding all of the cases originating east of the Mississippi River, and a colleague in Wisconsin has offered to handle all the cases originating west of the Mississippi. Veterinarians will be central to this. Veterinarians will be gender, age, race, and geography matched to MDs or DOs, our counterparts in the human world, and age, gender, race, and geography matched to people in the general public who are not involved in a medical profession and not involved in an animal profession. Also, our staff who handle fecal analyses, they will also be matched with medical staff and be matched with people in the general public. And our staff who have strictly clerical receptionist duties will also be matched with those representatives in the human world. So we will have controls, and our controls will have controls. We have just launched this. And Dr. Squires mentioned, we're odd, and when we talked to people in academia about this, they were like, no grant? No, we're a free enterprise. We're just going to be doing this. So veterinarians are going to be donating their time and their supplies, and the USDA is doing the testing. Okay, toxoplasma is a public health concern and it's environmental concern. As a society, we have already addressed health concerns and we have already addressed environmental concerns, and here's two examples. Okay, this is from 1946. I have been told that in the 1960s at conferences of cardiology physicians that the air was so thick with cigarette smoke you had to cut it with a knife. Who now thinks that cigarette smoking is healthy? Okay, Everglades. When I was in high school, if someone asked a preposterous question, a common response was, yeah, and I've got swampland in South Florida to sell you. The Everglades is no longer a joke. It's not for sale. It is a unique ecosystem that we need to do our level best to return to its original state and to keep it that way. Who thinks that we need to leave the pythons in the Everglades? With regard to songbird predation, what is the difference between a python and a feral cat? And let me ask you this. If the pythons had fur and purred, would we be so inclined to take them out of the Everglades? Conversely, if the cats had scales and slithered, would communities continue to fund TNR? We are on the leading edge of these projects, and at this point, we're not certain just where they're going to lead. As we move forward, let us strive for a world where far fewer people will be suffering from schizophrenia and where there are many more songbirds. I'm going to close with this image. This is what Toxoplasma gondii looks like under fluorescent antibody staining. And I'm going to wrap up with a quote from a client who was trained as a concert pianist, who says mental illness is still a dark box and we need to let in a little bit of light. If nothing comes of these silver projects, there will have been nothing wrong with a veterinary attempt to strike a match. I want to acknowledge Dr. Dubay from the USDA for believing in these studies, and my colleague from Wisconsin, without whose help we wouldn't be where we are today. I wouldn't be here were it not for the influence of all of these people and entities, and especially my clients. I welcome your questions. Thank you.